Good afternoon. The next item of business is portfolio question time, and the portfolio this afternoon is education and skills. If a member wishes to request a supplementary, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function during relevant question. And at question one, I call Willie Rennie.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on when it will deliver its commitment to reduce teacher class contact time by 90 minutes per week.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Galbraith.
The Government is committed to reducing class contact time for teachers by 90 minutes per week by the end of the current parliamentary term, and work is ongoing with our key stakeholders to achieve this aim. To help inform these discussions, I have commissioned an external modelling and research exercise which will consider a range of factors, including current teacher numbers, pupil-teacher ratios and the projected decline in the number of school-aged children in Scotland. Any reduction in class contact time will require the agreement of the Scottish Negotiation Committee for Teachers.
Willie Rennie.
God, this is so slow. To claim that the manifesto commitment, breathlessly delivered in 2021, was never intended for implementation for another 5 years, I think, frankly, is taking teachers for fools. Teachers are struggling now. They need the promise delivered now. So can the Cabinet Secretary set out exactly what she's done since she came to post to deliver this policy much sooner than when she has indicated that it would be delivered?
Cabinet Secretary.
I believe in my initial response to Mr Rennie, I did set out the action I've taken since coming to post as Cabinet Secretary to commission the external modelling work that we require at a national level to look at class contact time at local level. We don't yet have that detail. I don't yet have that report. That will inform the progress that needs to be made in relation to delivering this commitment. But I absolutely agree with the sentiment behind Mr Rennie's question, because reducing class contact is vitally important, particularly in terms of workload, and also, I think, in terms of school reform, which, of course, is another substantive issue that the profession will be responding to in due course. And I look forward to working with Mr Rennie to that end.
Supplementary, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Workload Reduction Task Force in England has made a number of recommendations to address teacher workload pressures. Many suggest that they're easily mappable onto a Scottish situation. Which of the recommendations does the Cabinet Secretary think are particularly worthy of consideration, and what's she doing to implement them?
Cabinet Secretary.
I have to confess to the member, I have not seen the Workforce Group for England and their respective recommendations, and I'm not necessarily sure that recommendations that have been made in other parts of the UK would always fit the Scottish system. That being said, I'd be more than happy to consider them and look at what recommendations have been made in other parts, recognising, of course, that education is devolved.
Supplementary, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will also be aware that similar reports were written in Scotland almost 10 years ago now, the Workload Reduction Task Force and the Tackling Bureaucracy Working Group, highlighting a number of areas, including forward planning, assessment, monitoring and so forth, that could help reduce workload. I know that the trade unions have written to the Cabinet Secretary about this report, so can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, will she revisit those actions in that report, and would she be willing to meet with trade unions and I to discuss it?
Cabinet Secretary.
I meet with teaching trade unions regularly, and this issue is one that I'm very keen to work with them on. I think actually it's part of our wider response to school reform in a post-COVID environment, and I recognise some of the challenge here. So I will continue to engage with trade unions and, of course, with Ms Duncan-Glancy on this issue.
At question number two, I call Annie Wells, who is joining us remotely. Ms Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to support staff retention and wellbeing in primary schools in Glasgow.
Cabinet Secretary.
Glasgow City Council are responsible for the employment of teachers in their area. That includes staff retention and wellbeing, notwithstanding. We are supporting the recruitment and retention of teachers by providing councils with £145.5 million to protect teacher numbers. The Strategic Board for Teacher Education is also considering issues around the recruitment and retention of teachers. The Scottish Government has allocated over £2 million to support the wellbeing of the education workforce, in addition to our investment in the historic pay deal for teachers, meaning that they are the best paid anywhere in the UK, and staff retention and wellbeing for primary staff is, of course, ultimately a matter for the respective employer.
Annie Wells.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response. Tory Glen Primary School in my region of Glasgow has had no fewer than 5 head teachers in just 3 years, with inspectors noting that despite the hard work and dedication of staff, the school was suffering from a lack of leadership. While individual circumstances are, of course, a factor in every school, this example, combined with that in Glasgow City alone, almost 37,500 days were lost to staff mental health absence in 2022-23. Does certainly give pause for concern. So does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that more substantive action is required to improve staff wellbeing across primary schools in Glasgow and beyond?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question. I think she raises a very important point in relation to teacher wellbeing. And since October 2020, we have allocated that £2 million to specifically support the wellbeing of the teacher education workforce. But it's really vital that staff in our schools and in our nurseries are able to access the right support that they need when carrying out their important duties. But of course, in this instance, Glasgow City Council is the employer. We have also, I should say, invested an additional £200,000 this year in supporting the wellbeing of coaching for staff who are working in schools and early learning and childcare. And I will continue to engage with COSLA on this issue, but I'm happy to engage with the member and, if required, with Glasgow City Council directly, because I do recognise and support the points the member has made today.
Supplementary, Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response in talking about the retention of staff across Scotland. So is the Scottish Government leveraging data and insights from the teacher numbers to inform future budgetary consideration and policy design, particularly in addressing the concerns raised by the Stand Up for Quality Education campaign regarding funding and resources for schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. Of course, we do already undertake our annual teaching workforce planning exercise. That's done at a national level, but it's informed by local requirements. And it looks at a statistical model which estimates the number of initial teachers required to maintain pupil-teacher ratios. And as the member will know, we have record low pupil-teacher ratios. And that is based, of course, from inputs around projections about the number of pupils in the education system, the churn in teacher numbers, so retirement, maternity leave, for example, and also the retention rates of ITE students. So there's been consultation on that exercise. It takes place in partnership with key stakeholders, namely, of course, COSLA, but of course, representatives from the DTCS, from our universities, from our teaching unions too, to the members' point, and from the SFC. So I will continue to work with our workforce planning partners to that end, but I recognise the point the member makes in relation to that forward planning, particularly for the needs of the sector and for the needs of our teachers too.
Supplementary, James Dornan, who's joining us online, hopefully. Mr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, a big aspect in attracting staff to work in Scottish schools is competitive pay. Can you outline how in Scotland this compares to elsewhere in the UK?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I think we've been really proud to support pay deals for the public sector across the boards. The current teachers' pay deal, of course, the most generous since 2001, and that 28-month deal has had a cumulative value of 14.6%. It means an overall increase of more than £6,100 for the majority of classroom teachers. So unpromoted teachers at the top of the main grade scale are also better paid in Scotland, with a salary of £48,516, which is certainly welcome news and I think shows how this government values our teachers in Scotland.
Question number three, Ivan McKee.
To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the Scottish Funding Council's decision to stop funding three of out of seven, almost half of Scotland's innovation centres.
Minister Graeme Day.
Also, Scotland has a rich research and innovation ecosystem which drives the creation of new knowledge and delivers economic, social and environmental benefits across the country. The Innovation Centre programme forms an important part of this ecosystem. Since its launch, close to £175 million has been invested in the programme by the Scottish Government, delivered by the SFC. This programme has and will continue to support the seven existing innovation centres until late 2024. But it was always envisaged that beyond this period, funding for the Innovation Centre programme would be reviewed by the SFC to determine future approaches to investment. Following completion of that review, four centres will receive further funding for the SFC. The other three centres have benefited from 10 years of public funding, which has built their capacity and will enable them to explore new models of public and private investment and continue to deliver impact. Additionally, the Scottish Government, via the SFC, will continue to support research and innovation in aquaculture, precision medicine and sensors and enabling technologies through its core funding of universities and colleges.
Ivan McKee.
Last year, the Scottish Government launched its innovation strategy, recognising its seven innovation centres as being at the heart of the delivery landscape. The strategy is based on identifying where Scotland has genuine world-leading potential in supporting those technologies. It calls for joined-up delivery across the innovation ecosystem. Clearly, the Scottish Funding Council didn't get the memo. Can I ask whether the government will be rewriting its innovation strategy, given that a significant part of the delivery landscape it relies on will no longer exist?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, Scotland's network of innovation assets is extensive and includes a number of centres of excellence funded by the Government, in addition to the SSC-funded Innovation Centre programme. As the Member knows, these include the National Manufacturing Institute Scotland, the Net Zero Technology Centre, the Medicine Manufacturing Innovation Centre, and a number of centres of excellence funded through the City and Region Growth Deals. And as he rightly points out, the Innovation Centre programme is an important part of this landscape, and the key aims of the SSC's recent review of the programme were to promote greater alignment in the centre activity with the Scottish Government's ambitions, including those outlined in the National Innovation Strategy. But public sector support for innovation is also provided through our enterprise agencies as part of the National Innovation Strategy's implementation work, which is underway with our enterprise agencies and our public sector innovation funding review, with a focus on increasing alignment of funds, reducing unnecessary duplication and addressing any gaps in the funding landscape.
Supplementary, Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There are clearly pressures on all aspects of the Scottish Government, including the Scottish Funding Councils. Can I ask the Minister, in light of these financial challenges, if he will commit to continuing the Scottish Government's prioritisation of the winding access agenda?
Minister.
Officer, I was delighted to see the progress we've made, highlighted by the Commissioner for Fair Access this week. The Commissioner also pointed out that this increase has not been at the expense of other cohorts of Scottish students, with increases in home students across the board. This, of course, directly contradicts claims we've heard previously from both Labour and the Tory party in this Parliament. Perhaps they might want to reflect on that, what they've heard from this independent source, and consider correcting the record. In the same week that this progress has been confirmed, of course, we heard calls from the Tory front bench to bring back tuition fees, which would put this progress at risk. And of course, Keir Starmer's U-turning on free tuition. But, Presiding Officer, specifically on widening access, we will not rest on our laurels. There is much work still to be done, and we will set about that.
Question number 4, Willie Coffey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it matches up the skills required in the economy with the courses on offer at Scotland's colleges and universities.
Minister Greentay.
President, Officer, as I confirmed to Parliament recently and as set out in the purpose and principles, the Scottish Government will lead skills planning at the national level and support the development of skills planning at regional levels, in recognition that we must better align our education and skills system offering with the strategic skills needed of the economy. We are developing these approaches in close collaboration with colleges and universities, along with other partners, particularly employers, and are currently looking to get the clearest possible picture of the skills need across government portfolios now and for the future.
Willie Coffey.
Thank you, Minister, for that answer. We know the self-inflicted damaging effect that Brexit is having in this area, and the refusal by Labour and the Tories to support returning to the EU anytime soon will not help this one bit. But could the Minister give some indication of what more we can reasonably do to help bridge this gap between what our local economies need and the capacity of our colleges and universities to deliver? And in particular, how can we encourage more young people to start their own businesses in the trades that our economy so desperately needs?
Minister.
Willie Coffey makes a number of important points there, Presiding Officer. But I think in all of this, we need to draw a clear distinction between skill shortages and labour shortages. I think that's incredibly important. There is an issue about access to workforce. Brexit has been a large part of that. And we are, to an extent, trying to mitigate the damage that's been done. But we are very specifically undertaking an exercise across government at the moment, whereby I'm asking colleagues across the portfolios to engage with employers and colleges and universities in the room to identify whether the cause behind some of the shortages that we're seeing relate to provision, and if so, what we can do to address those causes. There's a number of other measures that the government's taken, but Willie Coffey makes an interesting point about how we encourage young people to start up businesses, and I have to say I've seen in a number of our universities some good leading examples of that that we could roll out more widely, I think.
And supplementary, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you. Ensuring fair access to higher education is clearly critical in ensuring Scotland has the skilled workforce we need for the future. So can I ask the Minister for his response to the Commissioner for Fair Access report published earlier this week?
Minister.
President, Officer, I think I covered most of that a moment ago, but there is no doubt that the report makes positive reading. I think even our political opponents would have to acknowledge that. We have some ground to make up now to complete the journey that we set out on. And that's why, within days of receiving the report, I've tasked officials with looking at how we build on the achievements so far, including how we overcome some of the data sharing issues that are an impediment to enable us to move forward as we all want to do.
With regard to question five, I'm afraid that whilst Ms Chapman was hoping to join us online, we have noted that the internet connection has been coming in and out, and I don't think really there's a point in starting off something that we may not be able to complete. So apologies to those members who had sought to have supplementaries, but the internet connection is not stable. Question number six, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to ensure that pupils can interact with museums as part of their education to help address racism and the legacy of colonialism.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Goodrich.
Pupils engage with museums and exhibitions in a number of ways. For example, young people co-curated the Glasgow City of Empire exhibition at Kelvin Grove Art Gallery and Museum, which launched in November of last year. It's important we build on this approach, which is why the Minister for Culture, Europe and International Development accepted all of the recommendations of the Empire, Slavery and Scotland's Museums report last week. That includes the recommendation that museums should support efforts to promote and embed race equality and anti-racism in the curricula in a meaningful, effective and sustainable way. We will continue to work with Museums and Galleries Scotland to implement the recommendation, which aligns with our new Breaking the Mould anti-racist curriculum principles and supports our programme for government commitment to advance inclusive education and to promote a decolonised curriculum.
Faisal Chowdhury.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I did visit the Kelvin Grove Art Gallery last week. The Kelvin Grove Art Gallery have recently launched an exhibition, as the Secretary mentioned, entitled Glasgow, City of Empire. The exhibition worked with the communities to tell the story of empire and how it still affects communities in Scotland today. What discussion has the Scottish Government had with Education Scotland regarding access for children across Scotland to educational exhibitions such as this one, and how does it ensure that pupils are leaving school with a robust understanding of racism and colonialism and the impact it has left in our society?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question, and obviously we have exchanged some commentary on this in the chamber previously, so I recognise his interest in this matter. I should say it is a matter for local authorities to support schools in developing partnerships, whether that be with the Kelvin Grove or other museums in their local area. However, Education Scotland does have an important role to play in facilitating and also in encouraging those links between museums, schools and local authorities. So as an example, they have an online webinar being planned in April of this year to raise awareness of schools about the education resources within museums and also how to make use of museums as part of the school curriculum. An important practical resource is also the National Museum Scotland Atlantic Slave Trade Learning Resource, which helps to support the learning of teaching of the transatlantic slave trade component of a NAT 5 qualification. And Education Scotland will of course continue to promote this resource to schools, and I'm also conscious as we embark on a period of reform in Scottish education that we are cognisant of this work that's been undertaken by Education Scotland, and we support that through curriculum development that will be happening in the coming weeks and months.
Question number seven, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting local authorities to provide appropriate levels of special educational needs staff for secondary schools to ensure a safe and encouraging learning environment for all pupils.
Cabinet Secretary.
The most recently published figures indicate that almost £5.9 billion was spent on education by local government in 21-22, and spend on additional support for learning reached a record high of £830 million. We currently have the highest recorded level of pupil support assistance as a direct result of our investment of £15 million each year to help schools respond to the individual needs of their pupils. We've also outlined in the programme for government our commitment to work with teachers to provide additional professional learning opportunities while seeking to build on the additional support for learning action plan.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response. Another key factor, of course, in ensuring the learning environment for this type of education is the fabric of our school buildings. And I know that the Cabinet Secretary is aware of the significant issues with Castleby School in my own constituency at present. Could the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on what progress has been made on this issue by her officials since she met with the local authority last month?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question, and I recognise very much his continued interest in this matter given his constituency. We had a helpful meeting towards the end of last year with the local authority and with the member on this issue. And of course the Government and Scottish Futures Trust continue to closely engage with the local authority, and my officials are meeting with the Council again in the coming weeks to discuss the issues relating to the health elements of the proposed Barra and Battersea campus, which of course sit out with my own responsibilities. But I will write to the member with a further update once that meeting has taken place, and I'm very much committed to engaging with the Council directly on this matter, recognising the important points the member makes about the school building.
And supplementary, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We may have the highest level of pupil support assistance as outlined in the last response, Cabinet Secretary, but with a marked rise in the number of students with additional support needs, now almost 37% of all pupils, can the Cabinet Secretary provide what further specific measures are in place to increase the numbers of ASN teachers and support staff without abdicating the responsibility to local authorities?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question. Obviously, the number of pupils that have been identified with an additional support need has increased markedly since 2010. And part of the change there has actually been the way in which we measure additional support needs, which I think now is much more transparent than it has been certainly in the past. We have invested an additional £15 million a year since 2019-20. And we provide over £11 million of funding to directly support pupils with complex additional support needs and services to children and families. We have a legislative framework, though, that's really clear about the responsibilities for the provision of additional support for children and young people, and the additional support for learning action plan that I spoke to in my response to the previous member is the way in which we can enact change, working with local authorities, recognising the responsibilities at local level, but also those that sit at national level.
Question number 8, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you very much. To ask the Scottish Government when a decision will be made regarding the Scottish Funding Council's recommendation to end the regional colleges arrangement in Lanarkshire and Glasgow.
Minister Graeme
Simpson. Officer, my officials and I continue to work through the advice set out in the SFC's options appraisal to determine the most suitable way forward in the Lanarkshire and Glasgow College regions. I met with the chair of GCRB in December, and I'm due to meet the chair of the Lanarkshire Regional College Board next week as we continue to explore, as a first step, what could be achieved within the existing statutory framework to enable timely delivery of improvement. However, it is likely that primary legislation would be required for more substantive reform of regional college boards. But we've been clear that any changes must not weaken oversight and accountability of the colleges. Rather, it should further support regional coordination of skills planning and pathway provision.
Graeme Simpson.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer. At the Public Audit Committee on the 11th of January, Karen Watt, who is the Chief Executive of the Scottish Funding Council, spoke of a range of other issues that were delaying the consideration of their recommendations. Does the Minister know what these other issues are, and can he further expand on the actual timescale for delivering this?
Minister.
Well, the Chief Executive of the SFC would have to explain that herself. I mean, as I've indicated, this is a live issue for myself at the moment. We are working on finalising a position on both of these matters. I particularly recognise the urgency around providing clarity in Lanarkshire. And in Glasgow, I'm entirely mindful of the asks around reform and the rationale behind these. But if we are to change existing regional structures, I would want to be satisfied that the governance arrangements which replace these provided robust oversight of the activities of individual colleges, and that the new landscape encouraged cooperation and collaboration across the three colleges in Glasgow and beyond, and served to discourage any possible predatory thoughts or activities between institutions. But it is a matter that's live, and I would hope to be able to update members in the coming weeks and months.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on education and skills. And there'll be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change position should they so wish. Thank you.